So we'll start with the case. We have a 43-year-old man with a hypertension and 5-year history of difficulty in swallowing. And he is having difficulty in swallowing with both solids and liquids. And he's complaining of something sticking inside his throat. And he has also noticed sometimes he has a regurgitation of clear foamy liquid as well as some undigested food, especially after bending after dinner. His wife has suggested that he is having frequent coughs at night and he has lost almost 7 to 8 lbs weight. Also, he has some chest pains like condition without any radiation. An episode lasts for several minutes. So what is the diagnosis? So after he has shown to the hospital, some investigations were done. The first investigation done was barium swallow. And second investigation is esophageal motility study. This picture shows you the barium swallow. That means a radioactive material, barium sulfate, is solution given to the patient. And then we take an X-ray. So this barium sulfate sticks to the mucosa of the esophagus. So we can see the lining of the esophagus. So we can identify how is the shape of esophagus, what is the mucosa, any ulcer, any alteration, or any other structural abnormalities there. So this was the case. So I want you to understand what is the importance of the pharynx and deglutition. So this was the case presented to you. So we learn deglutition. Before that, many of you couldn't hear me properly in the last lecture. And I just wanted to revise you the interior of pharynx. This is the diagram. The same specimen we can have or we have in dissection hall, and you'll have to give viva on this specimen. So same features we can see in the specimen as well as in diagram. So this is a nasal cavity. Okay, you already covered the lateral wall of the nose. Then this is the hard palate. This part is soft palate. We have already covered that part. Then this will be the oral cavity. This is the tongue. This is mandible. This is hyoid. This is the posterior part of the tongue. This is epiglottis. Okay. So this is epiglottis. Then this is the araepiglottic folds, okay, laryngeal inlet. Then these are the vocal folds we'll learn in larynx. Then, so these are the three cavities: nasal cavity, oral cavity, and laryngeal. Behind these cavities, there is a one mucomuscular tube called as a pharynx. So in front, it is open to these three cavities, while in the back, we have the cervical vertebra. Above, we have the base of the skull and the body of the sphenoid, while inferiorly it is open or it is continued with esophagus. So this pharynx is divided into three parts. 1 minute. Okay, so the upper part which is behind the nasal cavity will be called as nasopharynx. Middle part which is behind the oral cavity will be called as a oropharynx or oral pharynx. And third part, which is the lowermost part of the pharynx, which is behind the laryngeal cavity, will be called as a laryngopharynx. So these are the three parts. Each one of these parts has some special features. So you have to remember these features. The nasal cavities or the nasopharynx, its roof has a lymphoid aggregation called as a nasopharyngeal tonsil. This tonsil has in the center have a mucous recess called as a pharyngeal recess. Okay. Then just above or in the roof, we have a adenohypophyseal like tissue, that is pituitary tissue. Then it is called as a pharyngeal hypophysis. So that might be remnant of pituitary tissue during development. So these are the features which we found in the roof of the nasopharynx. Now lateral wall, this part is showing the lateral wall. We can see an opening called as an auditory tube. So through this opening, this nasopharynx is connected to the middle ear cavity. This opening is present 1.25 centimeter below and behind the posterior point of the inferior nasal compound. So this distance is important for us. Then just above this opening, we have a tubal elevation. And on this tubal elevation, we have a lymphoid aggregation called as a tubal tonsil. Okay, so we have two tubal tonsils. From here, two folds we can see. One is called as a sulfingopharyngeal fold. Sulfing means auditory tube. So it is going from auditory tube towards the pharynx. One fold is called as a sulfingopalatine fold. So it is going from auditory tube to palatine, soft palate. So these are the two folds. So these are the features we found in the lateral wall. Okay. So that were the features of the nasopharynx. Then oropharynx. Oropharynx has a one special feature that is called as a palatine tonsil. Now we will see palatine tonsil in the different lecture. Just remember that it is present in the oropharynx. Now in the laryngopharynx, we can see is the piriform fossa, that is a lateral food channel on either side of the epiglottis. So these are the features you have to remember. At the C6 vertebra, pharynx continuation with the esophagus. So this was the revision of the previous class. Let's see next. Now in short, we'll see again the muscles. So we have three muscles, stylopharyngeus. As the name suggests, originates from styloid process and it is supplied by glossopharyngeal nerve. Palatopharyngeus comes from palatine epidermis and sulfingopharyngeus comes from auditory tube. These two muscles are supplied by cranial root of accessory nerve. All three muscles are inserted on the posterior border of thyroid cartilage. And all of these three muscles have the same action, that they elevates the larynx and pharynx during deglutition. So whenever the pharynx and larynx moves upwards, the bolus of the food can move downwards. Okay, so that is the action of these three muscles. Here we can see this is a styloid process. From here it comes the stylopharyngeus. Okay, now here we can see from palate is the palatopharyngeus muscle. I hope everyone remembers that the palatopharyngeus muscle, a part of muscle, surrounds the nasopharynx. So whenever it constricts the lumen of the nasopharynx. And because of that encircling of muscle, there is a mucosal ridge found. That mucosal ridge is called as a Passavant's ridge. We have already seen that in soft palate as well. Now here is auditory tube, and from the cartilage of auditory tube, a muscle arises called as a sulfingopharyngeus. Here we can see the posterior boundary of the thyroid cartilage. So all these three muscles, they are inserted on the posterior border of thyroid cartilage. Then again, the circular muscles, there are three constrictors, superior, middle and inferior, and they are placed like one cup into another. So they arises from different bones. Superior constrictor from the base of the skull, mandible and side of tongue. Middle constrictor from hyoid bone. Inferior constrictor, it has two parts. One is called thyropharyngeus, so it arises from thyroid cartilage. Second part is called as a cricopharyngeus, so it is called as a arises from the cricoid cartilage. So that is the origin of circular muscle. Now superior constrictor is inserted on pharyngeal tubercle, middle constrictor and thyropharyngeus, they both are inserted on median fibrous raphe. So it also arises from pharyngeal tubercle and goes straight downwards. And then cricopharyngeus muscle, it is a sphincter-like action, so it encircles the complete pharynx. Now the superior and middle constrictor, they are supplied by the vagus through the cranial root of 11th cranial nerve. While thyropharyngeus part is supplied by external laryngeal nerve and cricopharyngeus part is supplied by the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So this was the, in short, the circular muscles. Now we'll see, here you can see this is a palatopharyngeus coming from palate. This is a sulfingopharyngeus coming from the auditory tube. and this is a standard process. So here is a standard pharyngeus. Then here we can see the constrictor muscle. This is the superior muscle. We are opening the pharynx from inferior side. So here you can see this is a nasal cavity. This will be the soft palate. This is the oral cavity. This is a epiglottis. So this will be the laryngeal inlet. Okay. We have three muscles. The green one is called as a superior constrictor. Uppermost. In the middle, we have a middle constrictor, which is not visible here, and the inferior constrictor. Here also you can easily see the sulfopharyngeus muscle and stylopharyngeus muscle. So, actions of the constrictor. Contracts reflexly. So, whenever the food bolus comes in oropharynx, they contract reflexly and induce a wave of peristalsis from above down. So, because of this peristalsis, now the bolus of the food move downwards. The thyropharyngeus part of the inferior constrictor muscle is propulsive in action. So, it propels the food forward. While cricopharyngeus is a sphincter-like action, so it normally kept closed. Unless and until thyropharyngeus contracts, the cricopharyngeus is closed. Whenever thyropharyngeus contracts, the cricopharyngeus relaxes to receive the bolus of the food. So these actions are important to understand the deglutition. Now, this is a diagram showing all three constrictors. You can see they overlap each other. So all these three muscles are oblique in nature except the cricopharyngeal part, which is horizontal in direction. And it surrounds the upper part of the esophagus. Now that's why it acts like a sphincter. Now we have a difference in action between the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus. And also there is a gap between the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus. So this gap is the weakness of the pharynx or the inferior constrictor. So this weakest part is called as a Killian's dehiscence. Okay. What is Killian's dehiscence? It is the weak part between the junction between the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus. Now why it is weak? Because the action between of the thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus is different. Thyropharyngeus is propulsive and cricopharyngeus is sphincter-like action. Okay. Now that's why if there is a neuromuscular incoordination, that means thyropharyngeus is propelling the food but cricopharyngeus is not relaxing, the sphincter is closed. So what will happen? There is an increased intrapharyngeal pressure. Now this pressure is directed through this weakest point called as a Killian's dehiscence, and so the mucosa bulges out. As it is bulging out, it is called as a diverticulum. Now, this is called as a pulsion diverticulum or zincus diverticulum. Now, at first it may grow outward, but if it is continuously going on, then it can grow downward along the side of the esophagus. So, what is the problem here? Whenever the person is trying to swallow something, so food might not go into esophagus, instead it will go into the zincus diverticulum. So food will be collected here, it will then will catch the infections and there might be a chances of sepsis. So what will be the treatment? Treatment is that we can cut down the septum between the pulsion diverticulum and the esophagus. Okay, so that is the importance of the Killian's dehiscence. So that was the almost revision part of the previous topic. Now we will see today's topic, that is deglutition. The deglutition's simplest definition, it is a transport of bolus of food or liquid from mouth to stomach. So it is just a transport process. Or it can be defined as a sensory motor events which are initiated by recognizing the presence, taste, temperature and viscosity of food or fluid in oral cavity. And then it will be transported to different parts of the GI system to the stomach. So that is deglutition or swallow. Now, as pharynx was divided into three parts, same way this deglutition is divided into three phases. The first phase is oral, second phase is pharyngeal, and third phase is esophageal. Out of these three phases, the first phase, that is oral phase, is voluntary, while remaining two phases are involuntary. So in oral phase, the food passes from oral cavity into the oropharynx. In the second phase, the food moves from oropharynx to laryngopharynx, and it will be passed down to upper part of esophagus. And in third phase, that is esophageal state, the food will move from esophagus and towards the stomach. So it will enter the stomach. So these are the three phases of deglutition. Now we'll see one by one. So what is oral stage? So after keeping the food in the mouth, it has to be masticated. It has to be divided into small bits of particle, and it is mixed with the saliva. After this procedure, now the food has to move from the anterior part of the oral cavity towards the posterior part. So for that purpose, what will happen? The higher bone, which is present just below the mandible, will move upward and forward. It is done by suprahyoid muscle. Suprahyoid means the muscles which are present above the hyoid bone. The group of muscles are called as a suprahyoid muscle. So as the hyoid bone moves upward and forward, the tongue will move again upward and backward, and will be pressed against the hard palate. So now the food which is catched between the tongue and the hard palate will move backward. This action is done by styloglossus muscle. Now you have already learned tongue, so this is one of the muscles of the tongue. So now it will move from oral cavity to the oral pharynx through the opening called as a oropharyngeal isthmus. I hope everyone remembers, oropharyngeal isthmus is formed by soft palate above and palatoglossal arches on either side. This is a voluntary process. So we will decide when we have to swallow the first stage. Okay. Now the nerves involved in this process are three number. So first nerve is fifth nerve, that is trigeminal nerve. Now this trigeminal nerve is divided into three parts. That is maxillary, ophthalmic, and mandibular. The mandibular nerve supplies the muscles of mastication. So the mastication process will require the fifth nerve. Then seventh nerve is for the taste, okay, as well as the 12th nerve will supply the tongue also, and it is going to supply the muscles of tongue. So styloglossus is supplied by 12th nerve. So this is the oral stage where the food will be masticated and will move from the anterior part to the posterior part of the oral cavity, and will eventually it will shift through oropharyngeal isthmus to oral cavity. Okay. Now the as food moves to the oral cavity from the oral cavity to the oropharynx, it touches the back of the oropharynx. There are some receptors which are stimulated. These send the signal to the deglutition center of the medulline pons. So what will happen? They will receive the response that the person is swallowing, and they will send the written impulses to the soft palate. So this will be the soft palate as well as the uvula, so that the soft palate will move upward. Okay. And on the back side, there is a passerman's ridge, so it will constrict. So now the nasopharyngeal isthmus is closed up because of the passerman's ridge and the soft palate. Why this is necessary? Because now food is in the oropharynx. So whenever there are different openings, the food can move to these different openings. So we'll have to prevent the entry of food into the nasopharynx. Okay. So for that purpose, immediately the food moves to oropharynx, the nasopharyngeal isthmus closed up. Okay. So that is the second stage. Here you can see the nasopharyngeal isthmus is closed up. Now, the food cannot move upward, so it will have to move downward. Now downward, we have a laryngeal inlet. So laryngeal inlet, if it is not closed, the food might go into the larynx. So to prevent the entry of food into respiratory system, laryngeal epiglottis by the approximation of aryepiglottic foam. Again, I have to tell you that epiglottis does not fall back to close the laryngeal inlet. Then, so the food cannot move upward, the food cannot go into respiratory system. Still, there is one opening, that is esophageal opening as well as oral cavity. So food should not enter again into oral cavity. That's why we have to close the oropharyngeal isthmus as well. So this is done by palatoglossal arches approximation. So now food cannot go up, cannot move back, cannot go into larynx. So only one place to go, that is esophagus. So after elevation of larynx and pharynx through longitudinal muscles, that is stylopharynges, palatopharynges, and sulfopharynges, they will move the larynx and pharynx upwards, so the bolus of the food will go downwards. So now it will go towards the esophagus. Now this process, which is happening in the oropharynx, will also cross with the respiration, because this oropharyngeal part is a common passage for air and food. So when the food is in this part, the air cannot go from nasopharynx to the larynx. So that's why there are some effects on the respiration. So that is cessation of respiration during oropharyngeal stage of deglutition is called as a deglutition apnea. Now, how this happens? I told you that deglutition center is present in the medulla and pons. This deglutition center is very close to respiratory center. So whenever deglutition center is activated, it inhibits the activity or temporarily arrests the activity of respiratory center. So there is a temporary cessation of respiration. And because of that, it is called as a deglutition apnea. It is very normal during swallowing. Now, so we have learned, so what will happen in oropharynx. Now the bolus moves through oropharynx and laryngopharynx because of the constrictor muscles and palatopharyngeal muscle. Now they are propelling the food downwards. So now the esophagus has to receive the food. So that's why there is a relaxation of the sphincter, which is present in the upper part of esophagus. So now bolus will move or enter the esophagus, and that completes our second stage, that is pharyngeal stage. So nerves supplying the oropharynx and laryngopharynx are 9th and 10th nerves. And the muscles are also supplied with the cranial part of accessory. So there are 9th, 10th and 11th cranial nerves. So that completes our pharyngeal stage. So now we'll move towards the esophageal stage. Now bolus has entered the cranial part of esophagus. Now how it enters? So it has two ways. Either it will slip over the posterior part of epiglottis because the larynx inlet is closed, or it can move on either side of the epiglottis through the lateral food channel, that is piriform fossa. So these two ways the food will enter into the upper esophagus. Now as soon as the food enters into the esophagus, what will happen? The cricopharyngeal part, which was the sphincteric action, it will again close down. Why? Because to avoid the food is re-entering again into the laryngopharynx, as well as to prevent the aerophagia. Aerophagia means the food, air is entering into the esophagus, so we are going to along with the food bolus, more of the air will enter into the esophagus. So to avoid the aerophagia as well as regurgitation of food, again the sphincter closes down. So that is how this esophageal stage works. So you can see the food has entered from laryngopharynx into the esophagus. So now we have open nasopharyngeal isthmus, open oral cavity, open laryngeal inlet. But now this sphincteric action in the upper part of esophagus has closed down the cranial part of esophagus to avoid aerophagia. So that is the third stage of esophagus. Now As soon as the food or the bolus enters into the esophagus, there is a peristaltic wave which will pass down from esophagus to the stomach. So that now this bolus of the food along with this peristaltic wave move downwards and will enter the stomach. Now you have to remember the esophageal stage is completely involuntary, though in the upper two-third part of esophagus there is a skeletal muscle. So you'll have to remember, though it is a skeletal muscle, it is not voluntary. It is a completely involuntary stage. So in short, we'll see again the deglutition process. So after the food is chewed and mixed with the saliva, the mouth is closed now, the tongue will go upward and backward against the hard palate. So the bolus of the food will move towards the oropharyngeal isthmus. Now, after food enters into the oropharynx, the nasopharyngeal isthmus is closed down to avoid the re-entry of the food into nasopharynx. Oropharyngeal isthmus will close down to avoid the re-entry of food into oral cavity. Laryngeal inlet will close down to avoid the food entering into the respiratory system. So now, the bolus of the food will move downwards to the laryngopharynx. Through laryngopharynx, with the propulsive action of thyropharyngeus, the cricopharyngeus will relax and bolus of food will enter into the esophagus. As soon as it enters, cricopharyngeus again closes down the sphincter of the upper esophagus to avoid aerophagia. During the oropharyngeal stage, that there is a respiration cessation. This is called as a deglutition apnea. So deglutition is not a very simple process. It involves a high level of motor and sensory coordination. So if there is any problem or any incoordination in these processes, there will be problems with the swallowing, problems with chewing, speech, and there will be problems with respiration. So if there is any problem, you'll have to solve it quickly. Now, what is lower esophageal sphincter? Now, this is a sphincter which is has to again close down once the food enters into the stomach. So this esophageal sphincter has to transiently relax in between when it has to relax. So it is necessary for belching, vomiting, and whenever there is a regurgitation. At that time, this sphincter will open and will allow a transient movement of the either gases or food in the vomiting or regurgitation. So if there is a continuously this process is going on multiple times, then this sphincter's control will be lost and it will be causing dysphagia as well as GERD. So what is GERD? It is a gastroesophageal reflux disease. So this sphincteric action is also important during swallowing. So that was the deglutition. So I hope you understood deglutition. We'll again revise it fast in the end of the lecture. So if there is any problem with deglutition or difficulty in deglutition, then it is called as a dysphagia. So this dysphagia, as we have deglutition, have three phases, same as dysphagia has three phases. So there might be oral problems which is causing dysphagia, there might be pharyngeal problems, or there might be cricopharyngeal problems. So other clinical anatomy is megaesophagus. Next is deglutition and respiratory centers. I told you that deglutition and respiratory centers, they are very nearby. So whenever the person is swallowing and the food is in the oropharynx, then the deglutition center will be stimulated and it will inhibit the respiratory center. So there is a cessation of respiration. So again, if there is any incoordination between deglutition and respiration center, it will cause problems with swallowing as well as respiration. Then next point is phagophobia. So we'll see one by one. So dysphagia, what are the reasons? So in the oral phase, there might be cleft lip or cleft palate. Here you can see cleft lip means a normal lip is not formed Instead of that, there is a gap present between the lips. So that is called as a cleft lip, while this is a cleft palate. So we have a opening or gap present in the hard palate. Sorry. So what will happen? Whenever the food is trying to enter into the oral cavity to oropharynx, the food might go from the oral cavity to the nasal cavity through this cleft palate. So there will be regurgitation, there will be abnormal cessation of respiration, so there will be coughing and everything. So it will cause problems. So it again, it will cause dysphagia, that is difficulty in swallowing. So next problem is xerostomia. Xerostomia means dry mouth. So if there is no saliva, the food bolus will not perform. So it will not be a soft, but it will be a hard food particles, and they might cause damage to the mucosa, and they are very hard to easily swallow. So again, same, it will cause dysphagia. Next, pharyngeal lesions. They are mostly neurological disorders which cause the pharyngeal fields swallowing difficult. So they might be Parkinson's disease, myasthenia gravis, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, diphtheria in children. Generally, we don't found diphtheria in our India now because of the vaccines. So these are the mostly neurological reasons. So most of them are found in the elderly people. So third phase is esophageal phase. Now in esophageal phase, we have different reasons for the dysphagia. First is achalasia. So here in achalasia, the lower esophageal sphincter cannot relax whenever the person is swallowing. Next is diffuse spasm. Here you can see there is a diffuse spasm of the esophagus. So the peristaltic wave is not passing properly. It is not allowing the food to pass properly through this esophageal channel to the stomach. So again, it will cause difficulty in swallowing. Then esophageal rings. Here you can see, this is an esophageal ring. So the normal lumen of the esophagus is cut down, and the food might collect above this ring, and again it will cause difficulty in swallowing. Then esophageal cancers, tumors are present. So again, they will cut down the lumen, and lumen will be shortened, and so again it will cause dysphagia. Eosinophilic esophagitis. Obviously, the inflammation of the mucosa will cause pain, and again it will cause difficulty in swallowing. So these are the reasons of the dysphagia. So what are the symptoms? How you can diagnose the dysphagia? So there might be choking on the food, there might be coughing during or after swallowing. It might cough blood. They have a weak, soft voice. There might be some aspiration symptoms. They have difficulty in chewing as well. Food sticking in their throat. They will complain always that there is a lump in the throat, the food is sticking in my throat. That is the most common complaint. So these are the symptoms of dysphagia. Now we generally say what will be the problem. So complications are numerous. Some of them are this social distancing. But it's not because of corona. It is because of the continuously coughing, or there is pain in swallowing, so the person might not feel comfortable in the company of others. Then, as they have a difficulty in swallowing, so they will avoid the food, they will avoid to swallow the liquids as well. So they might, it might cause dehydration and malnutrition in the person, so they will lose weight. Then there are pulmonary complications. If food goes into the respiratory system, and because of the foreign body in the respiratory system, it will catch infection, and it might cause chronic aspiration or pneumonia. So they have a reduced quality of life, they cannot enjoy it. So these are the complications of dysphagia. Now that was the dysphagia. What is megaesophagus? But it's a fairly rare condition. In human, what happens, there is an absent motility in esophagus. As there is no motility, there will be no peristalsis. As there is no peristalsis, the bolus of the food will not move smoothly through esophagus towards the stomach. So again, the food will try to be collected in the lumen of esophagus. So here you can see the lumen of the esophagus. Because of the food, it has dilated and now it becomes quite large. So it causes abnormal enlargement of esophagus. So that's why the name is mega esophagus. It might also happen in aplasia. So in aplasia, what happens? The lower esophageal sphincter do not relaxes whenever the person is swallowing the food or after the peristaltic wave. So the food will be collected in the esophagus only, and so it will cause dilatation of the esophagus. That is aplasia, and this reason what happens after aplasia is the mega esophagus. Now I want to you just for this general information, that whenever the person is having a semi-solid or solid food, the food will move from the esophagus into 4 to 8 seconds. And if it is liquid, then it is less than 1 second. Now, psychological disorders. So one disorder is called as a phagophobia. Phobia means fear and phago means eating. So you have a psychogenic fear of the swallowing. If a doctor checks him or do any physical examination, cannot find any physical problem, or he cannot find any physical problem as well as on the lab test. So this is a psychogenic fear. Another one is called as a globus hystericus or pharyngeus. So the person feels that there is a lump or foreign body in the throat. So he might feel cancer, or he might feel there is something inside the throat which is blocking the esophagus, so that he cannot swallow it properly. So he will always try to clear his throat, and because of this continuous fear, he have post nasal drip which is trying to moisturize the mucus of the oropharynx and esophagus, and he'll have heartburn like symptoms. So this is globus pharyngeus. So these are the other two disorders. Now, in the first lecture, we have seen Mulder's ring. What is Mulder's ring? It is a ring formed by the lymphoid aggregations. Now, which aggregations are formed? So, posteriorly, we have a nasopharyngeal tonsil or pharyngeal tonsil. Posterolaterally, we have two tubal tonsils, which are above the auditory tube opening. Then, on our lateral sides, we have palatine tonsil on either side of the oropharyngeal isthmus. So they are present on the posterior one third of the tongue. And inferiorly, we have the lingual tonsil, which is present on dorsum of the tongue. So they form a ring-like structure and they guard the openings which are present in respiratory system and alveolar system. So these all lymphoid aggregations are very important. Now I hope everyone have understood the lecture, and they also understood the concepts. So this Mulder's ring is important. This palatine tonsil, or in general we call them tonsil, if they enlarge, then and they are blocking the oropharyngeal isthmus, then we'll have to remove these tonsils. If they are bleeding, they are blocking, then we have to do tonsillectomy. But these tonsils can be seen whenever the person opens the mouth. But if there is enlargement of pharyngeal tonsil, it is present on the back of the nasal cavity, the nasopharynx, they will block this nasopharynx. So they will block the posterior openings of the lung, this posterior coina. So the person nasal respiration is obstructed. So the person have to do the mouth respiration. Now, because of this, this generally happens with children, as they are very prominent in children and they get atrophied in adults. So the person's face develops different, their face looks different. So they are called as adenoid faces, because these enlarged tonsils are also called as adenoids. So these are the two important points I have to remind you. Then We'll come back to the case. Everyone understood the concept? Should we revise it fast? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So should we revise or have you understood?
I'll revise it once.
Okay, so before the case, we'll revise it fast. So we'll revise today's lecture only. So what is deglutition? So deglutition means the food enters through the oral cavity and then is chewed and mixed with the saliva. Then the food is placed in the middle of the tongue. Now whenever the person wants to swallow it, the hyoid bone moves upward and forward. And the because of the styloglossus muscle, the tongue moves upward and backward against the hard palate. So the food which was placed in the middle will now move towards the back. So through oropharyngeal isthmus, now it will enter into the oropharynx. Now, as soon as it enters the oropharynx, we have to close down the other gates so that food will not enter to them. So, first gate it closed down is the nasopharyngeal isthmus. As it touches the back of the oropharynx, it sends a signal to deglutition center. Deglutition center sends signal to soft palate. This soft palate will be elevated and the passavents ridge, the palatopharyngeus muscle which is coming from soft palate encircling the nasopharyngeal isthmus and going back. So, this will again constrict the lumen. So, elevation of soft palate and palatal pharyngeal speaker, both will close down the nasopharynx. So the food cannot re-enter or cannot go upward into the nasopharynx. Now food will go now move downwards. So we have two pathways again for that. One is laryngeal inlet and one is laryngopharynx. So laryngeal inlet is also closed down by the approximation of the aryepiglottic force. Again, I have to remind you that epiglottis does not fall back. Okay? So now the laryngeal inlet is closed. Laryngeal inlet is still closed, so it will not go into the respiratory system. So now it has again two passages. One is go back again into oral cavity or go down to the esophagus. Some food might go into the oral cavity. To avoid that, this oropharyngeal isthmus is also closed down. How it is closed down? By the approximation of palatoglossal arches. So now only one way is remaining. So the food will move downwards toward the esophagus. Now it cannot move on own. So what happens? There are the superior and middle constrictor as well as palatopharyngeus muscle which is coming from palate downwards. So these three muscles, they will constrict and guide the food from the oropharynx to laryngopharynx to the esophagus. So that is the pharyngeal stage of the deglutition. So now, as soon as it comes to the sphincter of the upper esophagus, thyropharyngeus, which is a part of inferior constrictor muscle, will propel the food forward. As it propels, the cricopharyngeus muscle will relax. As it relaxes, the food moves from the laryngopharynx to the esophagus. As soon as it enters the esophagus, the cricopharyngeus muscle will again close down the sphincter. To avoid, again, re-entry of food from esophagus to laryngopharynx, as well as to avoid the aerophagia, that means air entering into the GIT system. So, this is the deglutition process. The nerves which are involved are the 5th nerve, 6th, 7th nerve, 9th, 10th and 11th and 12th nerve. So 12th nerve supplies the muscles of the tongue, 7th nerve supplies the sensory sensation of tongue, 5th nerve supplies the muscles of mastication, 9th, 10th, 11th nerve they supply the muscles of pharynx. So that is the deglutition. Now during this deglutition, whenever the food is in the oropharynx, what will happen? The nasopharyngeal isthmus is closed down. So the air entering into the nose will not go downwards, or the air exiting from the lung will not move towards the nose. So there is a temporary cessation of respiration. This happens through inhibition of respiration center by the deglutition center. So this is called as a deglutition apnea, which is very normal. So any complication with this deglutition will cause problems with the speech, with deglutition as well as respiration. So this is a highly complex coordinated activity, and it has to be done stage by stage. So that was the deglutition. Now, any problems with deglutition, generally first common comes is the difficulty in swallowing. So that difficulty in swallowing is called as a dysphagia. Now sometimes there might be pain during swallowing. So that condition is called as a odynophagia. So there are different reasons for odynophagia, but sometimes dysphagia and odynophagia, they might be combined. So there are different reasons for dysphagia. They might be oral, pharyngeal, or cricopharyngeal sphincter incoordination. There might be lower esophageal sphincter abnormality, which causes achalasia. There might or megaesophagus. Then there is an incoordination between the deglutition and respiration center. So again, it causes difficulty in swallowing. And there are some psychological fears when it's called as a phagophobia and when it's called as a glomus pharyngeus. So you have to remember the complications of dysphagia. Now this is a megaesophagus. So there is an upset motility, and so the food will stick in the esophagus and it will cause abnormal enlargement. So these are psychological reasons. There is phagophobia and glomus hystericus. These are the two again different clinical anatomies. So we again come back to the case. So what was the symptoms? The person has a dysphagia for both solids and liquid, as well as he has some regurgitation of clear foamy liquid and undigested food. Now these terms suggest the food has not entered into the stomach. If it has entered into the stomach, it should not be undigested, and especially after bending over dinner. So the food is in the esophagus, it has bent down. So because of gravity, the food again come back to the oral cavity. And he coughs at night, and he has lost 7 to 8 of his muscle, weight. He has a chest pain which is not radiating. So what is the diagnosis? Obviously he has a dysphagia. Now what are the reasons? So oral reasons are not present. He do not have any neurological condition. So pharyngeal reasons are also excluded. So most probably esophageal reason. So the person has a achalasia. So what is achalasia? In the diagram you can see this is a normal esophagus and this is a lower esophageal sphincter, which is reinforced. Now because this sphincter do not open or do not relaxes, the upper part of esophagus, because of the increased esophageal pressure and the food, will dilate. Then it will cause problems with the peristalsis and this will cause a megaesophagus. So what will be the treatment? Now we'll have to cut open the lower esophageal sphincter. So this is called as a Hallux myotomy. So myo means muscle, tomy means incision. So we'll cut open the muscle. Will have, then this sphincter will relax. But now as we have opened the sphincter, we'll have to make sure this sphincter also works. So what we'll do, this procedure is supplemented by door fundoplication. So upper part of the stomach is wrapped around the lower part of the esophagus from anteriorly in 180 degree to 200 degree around it, and it will act like a second channel surrounding the esophagus. So the food will enter from esophagus again to a constricted part of the stomach, and then it will go into the stomach. So this total procedure can be done laparoscopically. So this is called as a laparoscopic LR myotomy and door fundoplication. So generally, this is the treatment for the achalasia, which is very commonly found, one of the common reasons for the